Hello, welcome to the Oxford Executive MBA Admissions Webinar. My name is Alejandra de Rojas, and I'm a recruitment manager for the Executive MBA program. And I'm here with my colleagues, Alex McNamara, who is the Senior Admissions Advisor, and we're going to spend today talking you through the whole process of applying for the Oxford Executive MBA program. So whether you are at the beginning of the application process or you are already working the application, we will be here to help you make it strongest application that you can. I can see we've got a large diverse group here already joining us for today's webinar from all over the world. So good morning, afternoon, or evening, wherever you are, and welcome. Next slide, please. We will start by giving you an idea of who we are. This is the Executive MBA team. And you can see here, we have Kathy Harvey, who is the Associate Dean at Zeit Business School, and Helen Sayward, the Executive MBA Program Director. We also have the admissions team with Joanne and Alex that will be handling your application once you have applied. But your first point of contact will probably be the recruitment team. Siobhan, the Associate Director, Hannah, who is handling the UK, Middle East, Latin America, and Oceania, Jonathan, responsible for North America, the Middle East, and Africa, and then myself, responsible for Asia, Middle East, and Europe. Next slide. In terms of what we are covering today, I will briefly provide you with more information about the Oxford Executive MBA, such as the program structure and a typical class profile. We will also be talking about the admissions process broadly. My colleague Alex will talk about the details for the application form materials you will need to provide, and we will cover some frequently asked questions. We will also offer you some advice on key areas such as the admissions essays. We will also talk about the next steps after you have submitted an application, potential interview, and response time. In addition to that, Alex will also provide you with more information about the Oxford University College. So the best way we prefer doing this is if you have any questions, please do ask them as we go along in the chat box, and we will answer your questions throughout the session. Please do feel free to ask any questions you might have. Thank you. Next slide. All right, so let's begin with by giving you a quick summary of the structure of the Executive MBA. At Zeit, we have two intakes per academic year. One that starts in January and the other one in September, with each intake typically consisting of around 70 students. The Oxford Executive MBA is a part-time program that allows the students to gain a full master's qualification without interrupting their professional careers. It consists of 16 to 18 week-long modules, spread over 22 or 24 months, depending on the intake, which means that there is a gap of 4 to 5 weeks, depending on the intake that you choose. The first module is going to be held online for everyone to ensure that your whole class can start their MBA journey together and to offer a level playing field for all, regardless of travel restrictions. In terms of the format, students are required to study for a duration of 1 week at a time, usually Monday to Friday with occasional weekend classes. And then we have some core international modules in Asia, North and South America, and two overseas electives in Cape Town and Palo Alto that you can choose. You basically have 13 core subjects in the first year, and then you choose your four electives towards the end of that first year, depending on your interest. In addition to that, we have two mandatory projects, the GOTO, Global Opportunities and Threats, Oxford, and the Entrepreneurship Project. The Entrepreneurship Project allows you to explore your entrepreneurial side, putting together a complete business plan and putting your program learnings and ideas into practice. GOTO, which is designated to stimulate your thinking, identify business opportunities, and come up with opportunities to challenges arising from very high impact global trends. Next slide, please. In terms of a typical study week, the Oxford Executive MBA includes a mix of in-person and some virtual learning. When you're in person on campus in Oxford to complete a module, this is what you might expect to see on your timetable. There are different ranges of subjects that you will complete throughout the week. There are also opportunities to engage with our cohorts, our careers department, and hear from guest speakers. And once a week, we will also offer you the opportunity to go as a group to have dinner at one of our university colleges. Next slide, please. Just quickly on the Executive MBA class, we have a very diverse group of people from many different sectors and also from many different countries by nationality and also by where people are based. 70 to 80% tend to fly from outside the UK, from all over the world, to come to study at SAI Business School. The average age tends to be 40, and the average years of professional experience, 15. Of course, there are very big ranges around that. In terms of gender split, we tend to welcome around 30 to 35% women onto the Executive MBA program. We would obviously love to have more gender parity in our classes, so we do encourage all women to make sure to apply before the upcoming Women's Scholarship deadline that is meant to be on the 3rd of April for the September intake. In addition to that, we are not the typical business school that only attracts students from consulting or finance. Don't get me wrong, you're also more than welcome and needed, but we also welcome scientists, lawyers, journalists, doctors, politicians, professors, students coming from NGOs. In the end, we believe that what truly enriches a whole master's experience is to be able to bring together a diverse set of perspectives. This is definitely one of the biggest challenges of the master's, but it will maximize your learning and networking opportunities whilst you're studying here with us. Next slide, please. Here is an overview of the application process. Please, next slide. It takes between 4 to 6 weeks and starts with the online submission of the application. You would need to submit your materials online throughout our online application portal. And then once we have all those materials, they will go for first review to the admissions committee. And they will decide whether to make that further. If they do, then you will be invited to the interview stage. And then after there is another review where the admissions committee will decide whether to offer you a place on the program. If you're successful, you will receive an email that will contain details of your offer. Next slide, please. Now, just to give you an idea of your own timeline, as I mentioned before, we have two cohorts per year, starting in September and January, and we always advise that you apply early. We operate on a rolling basis process, so your application will be reviewed as soon as it comes. The sooner you apply, the better, in order to guarantee a place on the program, have a wider choice of colleges, and in order to secure funding. Quickly to go over the deadlines. We have a list of deadlines that you can see here. We generally have 5 stages of deadlines associated with each of the program intakes. The ones in yellow are scholarship deadlines. For the September 2023 intake, you're still in time to put in an application, as the final deadline is going to be on the 24th of July. But don't wait until last minute to submit the application. If you're looking at January 2024, you can already apply. However, the application portal for J24 is not open yet. Nevertheless, you can start filling out the application form. And once it is open, most likely by the beginning of April, you will just need to select the right intake before submitting. As I mentioned before, when it comes to applications, we operate on a rolling basis process. Although there are stages that you should consider, such as scholarship deadlines and the final deadline. But whenever you submit your application, within about 2 to 3 weeks of submitting your application, the admissions team will be in touch whether you have made it through the second stage or not. Next slide, please. The tuition fee for September 2023 and January 2024 is £106,540, which includes all tuition, assessment, essential reading materials, meals, career services, and coaching session, membership of an Oxford college and the Oxford Union. The fee also includes accommodation for the core international modules delivered in India, China, or Peru. It is payable in installments. You don't need to pay all the fee upfront. If your application is successful, a 15% deposit is payable to secure your place, followed by 50% of the program fee a month before you start the first year, and the remaining 35% by the beginning of your second year. Next slide, please. There are a number of different financing options, and we can help you build a case for your company. If you would like any information, or even if your HR director would like to come and visit the school, we can arrange that for you. We do work with Prodigy Loans, who can cover up to 80% of the program fee, but there are also other loan options available. And so I would suggest investigating the various options and find out which one is the best for you. We have a number of EMBA scholarships here as well, like the EMBA Director Scholarship, the Women's Scholarships, Hashmukh Patel, and the Oxford Alumni Scholarship. So do have a closer look at our website to find out more information. There are also external scholarships, and one useful place to look is at the Oxford University website, which has over 1,000 different scholarships listed. And there will be some applicable to all the programs that we have here, so certainly worth 2 minutes to use the scholarship finder. My colleagues will kindly now share more information about all those different funding options on the chat box. Thank you. Next slide. All right, so let's get into the central part of this. I will hand it over to Alex to lead on this section, which is the actual admissions process.
Thank you, Alejandra. Hi, everybody. My name is Alex McNamara. As Alejandra introduced me, I'm the Senior Admissions Advisor for the EMBA program. And I've worked on the EMBA program for about 5 years, so seen thousands of great EMBA applications, and I'm going to talk a little bit about what our admissions committee are looking for when you submit your application and what kind of information you want to make sure that you're putting across within your application. So this is just a screenshot that some of you may have seen if you've already started your application. If not, this is the very starting point of our online application form accessed via the website. Now I'm going to talk about 6 key components that make up your application and the assessment of your application by our admissions committee. So firstly, as Alejandra shared, the class profile, our EMBA class is a very experienced, and there's a huge amount of value in the network. There's a really diverse number of professional backgrounds, international backgrounds, and so on. So management experience, we look for students to have and applicants to have at least 5 years of management experience. And that's a broad definition. And what we mean by that is that could be managing people, having direct reports. It could be managing a company, a strategy, a budget, and so on. And how you will emphasize this on your application form would be firstly through your CV. There's a template on the application form itself that you can use just to help to make things as concise as possible. And it just summarizes the type of information we're looking for in your CV. It shouldn't be pages and pages and pages, but we do understand that it might be 2, 3, 4 pages. Just where we want to see your career progression, how you've progressed through your roles, how you've got to where you are now, and then any other relevant information you think should be there as well. So within work experience, we're looking at your depth of experience. So whether you have any international exposure, the type of markets you work in, the number of reports you have, and we ask you just to summarize your current role and responsibilities within the work experience page of your application form. And what we're really looking for there is the potential contributions that you'll be making to the class and adding to the network as well. If you're invited to interview, then that will be probed a little bit further as well, your background, and as I mentioned, how you progress to your current role. So next, we're looking at your academics. Now, we understand that most of our applicants studied maybe 10 or more years ago, and as a result, it's been a long time since you've got your degree, if you have one, and it may not be wholly reflective of your academic ability or your ability to cope with the programme. And that's really what we're looking for when we're asking about your academics. So there's a qualifications page where you can input the details of each qualification you have, in particular your degree-bearing programmes, bachelor's degrees, master's degrees, any doctorate you may have taken as well, and then also professional qualifications. And we ask you to upload the transcripts of each qualification that you have. The transcript is the page that outlines the modules you've studied and the grades you've achieved in each module, and then your overall grade as well. And if they're not in English, we ask that they're certifiably translated into English, just to ensure that all members of our admissions committee are able to read your transcript and see your academic background. Now, you may not have your transcripts at the moment. So if you're considering applying or you're in the middle of your application, it's best to get in touch with the university you graduated from now and order your transcripts from them, because it can take a few weeks for those to come through, and they should be able to provide them to you fairly easily, either digitally or through the post, and you can scan a copy into your application. So you'll see on the slide here, we ask for a minimum of a second class uppers. Now that's a UK result, and we will establish an international equivalence if you've studied in another country. We will do that ourselves, and there's nothing you will need to do about that. You can just put the result that you scored. Now we take a holistic view of applications. As I mentioned at the start, we understand for lots of our applicants, it's been quite a while since they've studied. So if you don't feel you meet a second class uppers, you can still put together a strong application. It may disadvantage you if you don't have a 2-1 equivalent, but you can make up for that in different ways, such as having a depth of experience or through taking a GMAT score. Now, we ask all applicants to take a GMAT or an executive assessment, which is also delivered by the company GMAC. And for applicants who have over 10 years work experience, 10 years management experience, we may offer a waiver. Now, the GMAT is designed to test your quantitative skills, your verbal reasoning, your integrated reasoning, and your analytical ability. And this is, again, to help us to understand that you're going to be able to cope with the rigors of the programme. And it's good preparation for the program as well, because it's revisiting lots of the things you may have done school or university that you will then apply to the program. So you should consider taking a GMAT or EA, and it will strengthen your application if you meet one of these competitive scores outlined on this slide. So in the GMAT, a score of 600 or above, and on the executive assessment, a score of 150 and above. The executive assessment is designed for EMBA applicants to take without a huge amount of preparation, and really just builds on the skills that you may already have through your professional and academic background. Now, as I mentioned, you can apply for a waiver. You'll be asked in the application form, would you like to apply for a waiver, yes or no? If you answer yes, you'll be asked to write a waiver request. We recommend you write around 500 words and just outline those skills that you have that you think qualify you for a waiver. Now, you should address directly those components of the GMAT test that I just mentioned, your quantitative skills, whether that's through managing your budgets, your verbal reasoning skills, and your analytical ability. So if you're applying strategy and things like that, you can mention those. And if you've studied any quant-based modules in your degree, those modules will be on your transcript, and you could refer to those as well. But our admissions committee will obviously see the transcripts once you've ordered them. So that will then be considered as part of your application. So just make sure you're really highlighting where you have those skill sets. If you get in touch with your recruitment manager before you apply, they may be able to offer a little bit more guidance around your CV and to whether you should be encouraged to take a GMAT or whether you may be a candidate who might be suitable for a waiver. So, English language requirements. The programme is delivered entirely in English. It's assessed entirely in English. So if you are a candidate who is a citizen of an entirely English-speaking country as recognised by the UK government, then you will not have to do any response to the English section on your application form. You won't even see it. If you are not a citizen of one of those countries, you will be asked to meet our English language requirements. We accept the TOEFL, the IELTS, the CAE and the CPE, and we have minimum scores of those, which you can find on your website. I won't go into them all individually, but they would have to be taken within 2 years of the start date of the programme. The other option is, for lots of our applicants, they can apply for a waiver from the English language test. And there's two ways to do that. The first one is on the basis of your academic background. Now, being totally truthful to you, this doesn't apply to a lot of our applicants because you have to have completed a full-time degree, taught and assessed entirely in English, and completed within 2 years of starting the programme. So for our applicants, that's generally not possible because most people have been working for over 5 years to get their management experience. So the waiver that's most common for our EMBA applicants is on the basis of your professional experience. So you'll see there are four bullet points there that outline how you would apply for that waiver. So we want to see, we want to hear from you how you are using English in your day-to-day professional background. And if you are using English substantially in your professional background, you can write a waiver request to outline that. Again, up to 500 words, it doesn't have to be hugely long, but just to outline where you are using English in your day-to-day background, speaking, listening, writing, and reading. I'm going to come on to essays in a moment, but that will also be one way that you can really establish and show how good your English ability is. Because ultimately, our admissions committee just want to understand that you will be able to understand everything in the programme and you won't have any issues submitting assessments once you are on the programme if you're made an offer. Okay. References. Now, your references will be asked to comment upon your English ability as well. So if you are applying for that professional waiver on the basis of using English day to day at work, your referee can support that statement as well. Now, we ask candidates to submit a minimum of two references. Generally, we recommend they be professional references, but you could have one professional, one academic, for example. Now, we recommend with references that you select two referees that know you well, that can speak in detail about you. They shouldn't be an employee, so we recommend you select a manager in particular. That can be particularly useful context for our admissions committee, or a peer and a colleague. The referee will be sent a link via email as soon as you input their details into your application form. And the referee will then be able to submit the reference directly onto your application. So you don't have to have submitted your reference, submitted your application to have already received the references in support of the application. You can apply before the referees have submitted, but your application will not be reviewed until the references have been submitted. So this can be one thing that holds up applications. Alejandra mentioned we try and process applications through from start to finish in around 6 weeks. But obviously if we're waiting for a week or 2 weeks for a referee to submit their reference, that can delay you and your application won't be reviewed until we've received everything. So there can be a temptation with references to select the most senior person at your organization, even though they may not work with you day to day and they may not know you very well. And as a result, that can mean that some references can come back and they're not very detailed and they don't tell us very much about you. So really think about who you're selecting as your referee and to make sure that they know what you're like day to day and will really put some time into your reference as well. So essays. Essays are the part of the application that we receive the most questions about. Now we ask for three essays as part of your application, and this is really a chance to showcase your written ability and the type of submissions you would make if you were a student on our programme. So there are three essays, as I mentioned. There are two 500-word suggested word count essays. The first one, and you'll see the titles written out here on this slide, it allows us to get to know a bit more about you, why you're applying to the EMBA, what you're looking to achieve going forward. And you will have already thought about this as you considered to take an MBA, but really think about exactly what it is you want to achieve from the MBA and how the MBA will help you do that. If you're invited to interview, and I'm going to talk about interviews a bit more shortly, you will discuss this more. And it might be helpful to have some particular examples on hand as to what you're looking for from this MBA program to help you progress. The second essay is a self-reflective essay. It's again for us to get to know a bit more about you and what you will bring to the class and your personality as well. So the question asks how your closest associates would describe you. Now, this is not a reference, so you shouldn't ask a colleague to give you a quote. You shouldn't ask a colleague to write it. It should be from you. We want to see examples of your soft skills and that you can be self-reflective of your own ability. Your references will give us that context from other people that you work with or have a professional relationship with. Now, the third essay is the largest essay and probably what you will spend the most time over as part of your application. You'll see the question written out on the slide. Excuse me. Now, this essay is suggested a 2,000 word limit. We would recommend that you go up to 2,000 words because a shorter essay could be a disadvantage to your application. This essay will help to showcase your analytical ability, your verbal reasoning, the type of skills that you will have mentioned in your GMAT waiver. So this is again a good chance to support that as part of your application. It should be written for a non-specialist audience. So if you're using lots of jargon, make sure you try and explain it because our admissions committee is diverse in terms of their background. Get someone else to read it to make sure that it all makes sense. You're not using too many abbreviations that we wouldn't understand. Now, you can lay this out and you should write this as an academic essay. So look at the situation and what the question's asking, identify the problems, and then write your approaches with your advantages and disadvantages and offer a conclusion as well. That way you're making sure you're including all of the analysis and showcasing your analytical ability. It also helps to showcase your written English ability if you're applying for an English waiver as well. There can be a temptation to include things like tables or graphs, but you should avoid these because it is, as I say, the type of essay you might submit on the academic program. So make sure it's text, it flows well, it's written well, and really showcases your ability. It should be written about your organization, but everything will be treated in the strictest confidence. So just some general essay advice. Read the questions carefully, particularly those word counts. Avoid short weight answers. You know, these essays also help to show your commitment to the program. And if your application form essays are shorter than the suggested word count, that may be indicative of the type of essay you would submit on the program. So just be careful of those word counts. Avoid repetition and narrative. So be as concise as possible, particularly those first two. 500 words is particularly short to kind of summarize your ambitions going forward. But just try and be as concise as possible. If you're invited to interview, as I say, this will be quizzed out a bit more. Check your spelling, punctuation, your grammar. Explain any acronyms and abbreviations. You can do this once at the start of the essay, but just be careful to make sure that everyone can understand it. And make sure it's your own work. Don't copy it from anywhere because we do have software to check where that's coming from. And that will obviously be a big disadvantage to your application if you've plagiarized it. So post-submission, you've covered off all of those bases, you've put time and thought into your application and you've submitted it. And as Alejandra mentioned, your application goes for a first review, and then if successful, you'll be invited to an interview. Now, all candidates who are made an offer would first be interviewed. So, I'm going to talk a bit now about what the interview structure looks like. The interview will take around 30 minutes up to a maximum of an hour. It will be a discussion one-to-one with an interviewer who will have read your application in detail. So we suggest that you reread your application as well, in particular the essays, because you will be quizzed on those. Be familiar with the EMBA course. So have some specific examples, have done your research, maybe speak to some of our current students or alumni just to get a sense of what it is you're applying for, just to make sure you know that you've thought out your motivations and why you're applying. So what may be in the interview? So I mentioned they'll discuss your essays. So we really want to get to know the type of contributions you'd make if you were a part of the class. You'll learn as much from your classmates as you will do from the faculty, and we really encourage classroom discussion. There's so much value within each EMBA class and that professional and international diversity that we want to get an idea of the type of thing that you will offer to the class. So you will be challenged on your essays, particularly essay 3, where you are outlining these problems. You'll be quizzed a bit more and asked to expand upon them. The interviewer will have a knowledge of your background and try to understand a bit further and challenge you in this kind of Oxford tutorial based process. Your motivations, which I discussed, a bit more about your current role and how you got there, just a chance for us to get to know you a bit better. And cross-checking the information on your application form as well. It's also an opportunity for us, as well as us, to get to know you better, for you to get to know us better. So your interview would be with a senior member of staff or an industry advisor or a faculty member. And they will have insight into the programme and the school, and you'll be able to ask questions around that as you go and at the end of your interview. We make sure we leave time for that. So think about what those might be, if there's any particular information you might look for. After your interview, your application would go back to our admissions committee with that interview feedback, and it would be reviewed again. A decision would take up to 2 weeks, so we try and return it sooner. If you are successful, we will notify you via email, and we will then send you a full offer pack, which contains all of the information relating to your offer. So that would include 3 main conditions of any offer we make. Firstly, we want to verify the qualifications. So we would ask for original copies of transcripts that you have. So again, I mentioned thinking about that at this point before you've applied. That's also relevant for if you're made an offer as well, because we'll ask to see those. A deposit invoice for payment. Alejandra broke down the structure of the course fee. We ask applicants to pay a deposit of £16,000 to secure their place on the programme. Initially, we would ask for that within 30 days in most cases, unless you're applying much closer to the start of the programme. But if you are applying now and you think you want a bit more time, you're arranging company funding, then we can have a discussion and we'll be as flexible as possible. And then you need to think about visas. So as this is a part-time programme, it's not possible to get a full-time UK visa on the basis of this particular EMBA. So all of our students will apply for a visitor visa, and that will allow students to come and study in the UK for each of their modules, and a little bit of flexibility around that, and then leave before returning for their next module. And we'll be able to offer you a first point of contact for any questions around visas. And then the university has a specialist student immigration team as well for more detailed expertise around that. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about the college system. Now, this can be a little bit confusing. It's a very unique part of the Oxford experience. And it's your opportunity, if you are an EMBA student, to make the most of the rest of the university and the wider university. So as an EMBA student, you'll see on the left-hand side, you will be a student at the Said Business School. The Said Business School is the business school of Oxford University, and we are what's called a teaching department. There are also teaching departments for subjects such as music, history, science, and so on. So all graduate students at Oxford will be taught at their teaching department, in this case, the Said Business School. So all of your lectures, your assessments, your main network, your kind of experience will really be defined at the business school. You will also be a member of one of Oxford's 39 colleges. The colleges are an extra network for you to access. It's an extracurricular part of the Oxford experience. So your EMBA network will be based at the business school, And that's really what you'll want to tap into. That's where you'll get the most value from the network, because it's like-minded students like yourself, similar stage of their career, doing their EMBA to progress their career and their skill sets. And you've seen the class profile as well and what that will offer. Your college will then offer an additional network of students, not just from the business school, but also from other teaching departments, like I mentioned before. So, you know, that might be useful to you if you're starting a new venture and you need some scientific expertise to offer some insight into your new venture. You could go to your college and connect with the faculty there or the students there to widen your network and make the most of that wider Oxford University network. The college will also offer facilities like sports clubs or libraries and things like that. They may also offer accommodation for those week-long blocks when you're in Oxford. They will also have lots of different guest speakers, performances, things like that as well. Alejandra mentioned that you'll go to one college dinner during each module week as well. So you'll get to experience lots of the different colleges at Oxford and that kind of history and architectural architecture around Oxford as well. So a little bit more about that. 39 colleges in total around Oxford. Around 20 of them take EMBA students. So in a class of 70 EMBA students, there may be around 10 to 20 colleges represented. So you may not be at the same college as all of your classmates, but you'll get to experience each other's colleges by taking each other as guests. And you'll see these photographs on the left-hand side, Keble College and St. Hugh's College. And they take quite a large number, up to 20 from each intake. And they'll offer you a great experience at whichever college you go to. Oxford has all of these wonderful buildings, but it's really built upon the people inside them. So your network within your college will be full of Oxford students, Oxford quality students and faculty as well. And then you'll have the history and architecture. So the business school is a much newer building in Oxford terms, but you'll have those really old and historic buildings around the rest of Oxford. And the college is that network, that facility that allows you to connect outside of the business school with all of those other Oxford graduates and alumni. So I'm going to hand back to Alejandra now, who'll talk you through a little bit the next steps from where you can go from here.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you for sharing all that useful information. Thank you very much. And now let's take a look at the next steps. We would welcome you to get in touch with us. So here are some of the next steps for you. If you would like to find out more about your profile, please do send us your CV for review. You are also more than welcome to get in contact with the recruitment team. You can see our details listed here beneath on the slide. And if you submit your CV for review on the website, it will automatically be sent to the recruitment manager responsible for applications for your region. Please do also take a look at the upcoming events hosted on our website. And if you're ready, please do feel free to start your application. Thank you for listening. Good luck with your Oxford Executive MBA application and enjoy the rest of your day.